Now, research has shown that millions of South African girls still miss school while on their period because they can't afford sanitary pads. A Caring for Girls program by the Imbumba Foundation, is raising money to end period poverty. In fact, lawyer and activist Songezo Mabece has partnered with the foundation to summit Mount Kilimanjaro to help raise funds. In fact, he joins us in studio this morning. Songezo, it's great to have you here. Thank you so much for coming on.
Good morning, Michelle.
I mean, you'll paint a picture for us, as you did for me when we were off air, about the situation insofar as girls missing such a substantial amount of school because of this issue.
It's a great opportunity to be here. Thank you so much for the invitation. Yes, it is a problem. It does not accord with, ultimately, the national consensus and contract that is espoused by the Constitution that perhaps these sorts of conversation, as time progresses, we have less of.
Mm.
Unfortunately, South Africa doesn't seem at a socioeconomic level to be meeting the targets set by ultimately the framework of the Constitution that should allow this conversation to be less of an issue next year and for the years after that. The numbers that you have just talked about are but scratching the surface, if at all, because there are many, many people out there, young girls, women, who just cannot access formal spaces of training where they can then indeed lend their part to the development of the society simply because of a natural phenomenon that will never, by virtue of me being a man, affect me or anybody who is a man. And I think that's just an inherent flaw in the arrangement of our resources, public and private, that perhaps can be better configured to attend to that.
So from a policy position, do we have the policies? Is it a case of we're not acting on existing policies, particularly insofar as young girls at school is concerned?
I wouldn't know much about policy, save to say this. The reality is, whatever the policy is and whatever resources that are spent in that regard, they are not doing their work as optimally, perhaps at least as they should. Your lower quintile schools have got, obviously, the challenges at a socioeconomic level that you and I are all too familiar with. One would hope, if not imagine, it should be one of the challenges that are directly targeted, ensuring that the availability of sanitary pads and related hygiene products are available at those schools. Let me take you back two decades ago in this country when we were gripping with the AIDS pandemic. There was a deliberate government message in partnership with the public and private sector. It went as far as the Constitutional Court even to force government to roll out ARVs, for instance. The point of that is there was a broad national conversation engaging the competing interests, but a conversation nonetheless as to how we can best tackle HIV and AIDS. Well and good, we have made some serious ground in that regard, not to suggest that AIDS at all is not a factor in the healthcare arrangement of the country. But when you look at this, young children not being able to go to school, it might not present as a problem now, and I present it as a problem, but certainly later on in life, it becomes a big problem from a social investment perspective. So if you're missing 10% of your school time, particularly girls in high school, it translates probably, for the most part, for that young lady into university. And many, and you might relate, in the workplace at times simply cannot be productive. And you get conditions like endometriosis, which are just debilitating for a young female, or even one who's not so young. The point is the loss of production as a result of inadequate access to these basic healthcare products, I believe, is part of the challenge that we as a nation should better engage. I mean, these are constitutional questions, ultimately.
Absolutely. I mean, is the discussion, yes, your focus is on the sanitary towels issue insofar as young girls at school is concerned, right? But is there a broader discussion to be had on a policy level for the treatment of women in the workplace, given these very particular ailments?
Yes, there's always room for such discussions. It starts in the home, in the schools, in the workplace, in parliament. Because if, let's say, the policy is optimally utilized, and yet we have the numbers that we have, clearly we need to adopt the policy or the agents who are implementing the policy. So at any given time, there will be room for this conversation to be had. I'm minded to refer to the Constitution and the socio-economic rights arrangement espoused in Chapter 2. I mean, you're talking about the right to education. I want to just focus on young girls because at least that's where my passion for now is at. Young girls have a right to education just like young boys do. Section 28.2 of that Constitution talks about the best interests of a child. those best interests of a child are not being catered for. If a young girl has a different schooling experience to a young boy, it's not just being absent from school, in other words, less contact time for substantive schooling, but the extracurricular activities as well, that probably would not be there. Yeah. So their experience of school becomes remarkably different to that of the boy, and their ability to express themselves, to develop, and so explore their talents is similarly stymied.
And I'm sure, you know, if there's a young woman who is watching the interview with you now, as I feel, you feel seen by these issues being put on the table as serious concerns, and as you say, constitutional issues. So you're climbing Kilimanjaro at the end of October. It's in an effort to raise awareness around this issue, to raise funds. I mean, this kind of, you talked about targeted advocacy programs.
Yes.
Hopefully it has the kind of impact that you're intending it to have.
I certainly do. I mean, I'm working with Sports for Lives Foundation. They are the implementing agent, they have effectively assisted me collect the resources. We're raising funds, 110,000 Rand and 50 Rand is what I've been able to raise, thankfully through calling a friend and a friend who knows a friend. So Sport for Lives is that platform that has helped me put these funds together. The implementing agent, as they have been doing, because Caring for Girls is part of their work, is the Imbumba Foundation, who've been doing this now for in excess of 10 years. In fact, yesterday they launched the 11th Trek for Mandela expedition to take place next year in the winter. I'm effectively just being a mouthpiece of those institutions who are better placed than Songezo is to deal with this kind of thing. But I think the important aspect for me, as let me call myself an activist for present purposes, is to help them get their message across. And if Kilimanjaro is the way to do that, then it is.
And we wish you all the best, and hopefully it does have the results that you're aiming it will have. Songezo Mabece is a lawyer and activist. He's climbing Kilimanjaro at the end of October. It's all around this Caring for Girls program and the Imbumba Foundation, raising money to end period poverty.